What's up, guys? Let's do this mass balance course overview. I'm very happy that you've chosen to start your mass balance course. Probably you need it or you just want to learn extra information. This is me, Chemical Engineering Guy, and we're going to see this block. I'm using blocks MB1, MB2, and MB3 and 4. These are the actual theory blocks. MB0 and MB5 are just, for example, this is the overview of the whole course, and this here is the conclusion of the whole course. So the actual content is here. MB1, it's the introduction, basic concepts. We're going to see that later in some minutes in this video. MB2, it's also about single phase, gases, everything else. We're going to see that also in this video. Then we go to multiple phase, which I think is the most interesting part of the course, because you're going to use MB1, MB2 and MB3 theory concepts. And finally, we jump to transient state, which is also very interesting concept. Many mass balances courses in many universities don't teach that much this part here because they see it in energy balances or so. But I think you can start doing it. So if you're interested, you can go and see it. The good thing is that if you are not interested, you can just jump it. So let's do it. First thing I want to tell you is the content. We're going to see a small introduction on why is it important to study this. I didn't choose it. It's not because I wanted to. It's very important for chemical engineers, chemical plants, factories, production, etc. And actually, many people tell me it's about only chemical engineering, but it's not only chemical engineering. You can do process engineering, you can do mechanical engineering, you can do anything that produces stuff that gets something in, into a process and out of the process. It's essentially a mass balance. Then we're going to see the source, which book I'm basing my course and other books that you might also like. Then we go to the basic concept you need to know, like multiplication, differentiation, some basic concepts in chemistry, physics, that I'm not going to explain you. I'm not going to explain you how pressure is derived, how do this equals force on our area. I'm not going to explain you that. I'm not going to explain you the gravity. You should know that. What's gravity? That's more into physics. I'm not going, of course, tell you how to derive an equation. I can solve it for you, but I'm not going to teach you how does that work. That are basic concepts that you already know, or you should know at least. Now, if you have the book, we're going to see the book next. We're going to see the introduction, which is essentially the first step to understand what is a mass balance and how does it work. We're going to see different units and that. That's chapter number 4 of the book, and that's 50% on weight. I think this is almost half. So if you jump this, you will not get these 20, 20, and 10%. So once you get that, hopefully you do it, you need to go to chapter 5, which is single phase. It's only about gases. We see a little bit liquids and solids, the advantages on their densities, that they don't change with pressure and temperature. But then we see essentially everything about gases. The ideal gas, real gases, compressibility, whatever. This is, I would say, 20% of the course. Then we jump to this multiple phase, which is very, very important. It has a lot of theory. The important part here is that it will help you to understand other concepts in other classes. So when you go, I don't know, to thermodynamics, you will say, oh, I remember that. For example, in thermodynamics, you will see the ideal gas equation, which you probably seen before. And you will see, oh yeah, I saw that in my mass balance course. Or maybe you will see boiling points and diagrams, phase diagrams, and you will be happy to know that you already see that stuff. So yeah, that's chapter 6 in the book. It's also 20%, but the thing here is that there are a lot of concepts, so take care of that, guys. Take care in thinking that only 20% of the course is almost not that much, but it has a lot of content. And finally, we jump to transient state, which I told you before. It's not that common to see transient state in mass balance, or at least it's not that representative. But I think if you get this, you will get a lot of problems that you will understand in general in engineering, in your daily life, whatever. And this part is only 10%. I didn't want to add up extra because maybe your course in your university doesn't have this, you will be just ignoring this part. So it's only 10%, so you can get it. And yeah, essentially that's everything, guys. Let's keep going. So the first thing that should pop in your mind is, why are we studying this? I always wanted to know that. I hate it when teachers just pop up into the content and I was like, what the hell? I need to know why I'm going to study that in order to see if it's actually important or it's just a general course or whatever. So why mass balance? First of all, because you're going to use it in plant design. You're going to understand how much stuff goes in, how much stuff goes out, and essentially stuff, or I like it to call stuff, but it's actually matter, mass and substances, they cost, they have money. So yeah, it's common sense that if you are throwing away gas, natural gas, you can burn it and do stuff with that, or even you can sell it. But if you don't know that and you're just dropping away, either because you don't know it or because you know it and you don't care, I think it's not a good idea. So that's the essential importance. Now, plant design implies equipment, use of equipment. A plant is made of many, many equipments. And how do you do those equipment? You are going to design a heat exchanger for a certain amount of mass. That's, for example, also pumps. You're going to use some amount of matter, you're going to pump that, how much energy you're going to use that, how much it's going to cost, whatever. You need to know how much matter you're going to have there. So there are many, many equipments. I'm not going to list them right now, but it's going to help you to do that. Also, you don't need to know, actually, for example, if you go with the financial boss, he doesn't want to know how the plant operates or how the equipment operates. They just want to see how much are you getting inside the process and outside the process. How much is going out, how much can you sell, and how much can you reprocess, and whatever. So you're going to analyze raw material versus products. And of course, byproducts. And essentially, I told you guys, this is everything to get the best of the profit. So get more money. And imagine you're an engineer and you see there's a leak and nobody cares because the process has been there always like that. And you discover you do a mass balance because it's typically process engineers always do that. They see an opportunity, they check it, do the math. Thank God you know mass balance. And you see that there's an opportunity, you're leaking, I don't know, let's say 5 kilograms of benzene. And you know you could, let's say per second. And now, since the process was always like that, no one knows that, and you see this opportunity and you go to your boss and you tell him, hey, we could get these 5 kilos into another process and make a reaction, or even you could directly send it to the client, whatever. So you get savings there, and that's good for the company, for you, your boss, and everyone is happy. So we're going to see this type of diagrams in general in engineering. You see there's a inlet here, you have coal and water. Probably they're going to do a slurry here. They send it, they send oxygen, they're going to burn it, they're going to take it out. They call this syngas, it is essentially a gas which is combustible. You're going to cool it and then you send it here. There's a byproduct here, then you take out all the particles. You're generating this stuff, which is going to be sent as a byproduct. And what you are going to essentially do is generate heat energy. But of course, it's not about energy also. It's about mass. What are you doing with that mass? That syngas, where does it go? You're going to have a byproduct. You cannot just let it there and essentially it's going to build up like a mountain every day, bigger and bigger. You need to dispose that. And once you get this fuel, you can burn it, generate electricity, which is typical for electrical engineers and all that kind of stuff. But the important part here is to improve this chemical reaction, which is burning or combustion. Get that syngas burned at the best as you can do it. Take all the stuff you don't need and generate electricity. And electricity, you know, probably, hopefully, it costs money. So the cheaper electricity you get, the better. And yeah, you can see the essentially the byproduct is heat. No, the byproduct is here, this slag mountain. And the important product, indirectly, is electricity. For us engineers, it will be the hot gas, the hot steam here. This will be our precious product, steam, which is hot. It has heat. So yeah, now I think you're getting the concept, hopefully, that we are going to see how that performs here, how these perform here. Maybe you have this, you could, I don't know, get that stuff back. Instead of just throwing it away or disposing, you can get that away. Or you can see that you have, I don't know, more mass that you can combust here. Why not send it to a plant or chemical plant that separates that burning stuff into another fuel, and you reburn that and you get more heat energy, and you, I don't know, maybe you can improve or increase the temperature here, and increasing temperature always get into a better gas turbine efficiency. And yeah, essentially it's that, guys. I don't want to be so technical in this process. We're going to see in general that that's the importance here. Another one, probably you know this one, crude oil, which is petroleum. You just take it here to this distillation unit and you have a lot of things to do. You can get naphtha here, you can get gas here, you can get kerosene, which is jet fuel or the fuel that airplanes uses. You can get light gas oil, which is burn it, I don't know, for example, it's diesel and that kind of fuels. Then heavy gas oil, which is used by ships or huge container tanks, whatever. And then they call this residue fuel oil, or I call this also asphalt, which is used for streets. So imagine you're an engineer and you're doing your mass balance and you see that there's an opportunity. If you send this once again here, it could be used to burn, or maybe if you turn this here, it can improve the quality conversion. Let's say gas and naphtha are super precious. Let's say these are very, very precious. And these two are not precious at all, or not that much. So what you want to do is to, if it were possible, of course you need to know the chemistry around that or process around that. The good thing will be, how do I use mass balance techniques to improve my performance of these? Also, I don't know, you have this water inlet, you have going out the brine, you're going to understand also how to read these diagrams and whatever. You also have this crude oil going out, maybe you can recycle that crude oil with this, whatever. Hopefully you're getting the idea. And well, maybe that was not just enough for you. I would think that's enough. Know how to read this and understand and improve that. But if you are not satisfied with that, you will need this for your next courses. So if you're studying chemical engineering, you will need to use these mass balances on these courses, which probably you don't know that much. Maybe you know them. I think you should at least read what they are, but I'm going to tell you why are you going to use these concepts here. For example, in energy balances, you the first thing you need to know is how much mass is going to go inside. So if I tell you you need to burn a house, you need to know how much is, how big is the house. If it's a small house, a big house, a huge house, maybe a mansion, you need to know how much gasoline you need to burn that. Or even if I tell you I need you to get a cup of coffee or maybe a pot hot, how much gas or how much time I'm going to be burning that. You need to know that, how much mass is inside, whatever. Then thermodynamics is essentially, you need to know if it's a closed system, an open system, continuous system, whatever. So you're going to understand that in this class. Now separation processes, you know to understand, know how to get these mass quantities. We're going to be talking about concentrations, maybe even refluxes, recycling. You're going to see that here. Also, heat exchange is similar to energy balance. You need to know how much mass is going in and how much mass you need to increase in temperature or decrease in temperature, or maybe condensate, boil, whatever. Momentum transport, you need it for the mechanical equation. If you don't know how much, let's say, Pumping 10 kilograms is not the same as pumping 1 gram. You will need, maybe here, a huge pump, and this might be a very, very small pump. And of course, the bigger the equipment, the most money it costs. So please, guys, be sure to understand that this is very, very important. Oops, I forgot this one. Plant design. I told you before, it's one of the most important things a chemical engineer will do. It's know how much quantities go in the product, in the reactants, raw materials, byproducts, whatever. And yeah, essentially that's the importance of mass balance in the next courses. Now, I talked about the book. Let's talk about it. That's the title of the book, Elementary Principles in Chemical Processes. The author is Richard Felder and this guy, Rousseau. I used the third edition. I don't know if there's a fourth edition, probably. As I know, there was no fourth edition, but if you want to relate all the things, pages, chapters, problems, whatever, please go to this third edition. So this is what you get if you go to Amazon. This is the picture of the book. I recommend you to buy it. It's always good to have your library of chemical engineering, especially if you are going to be working in chemical engineering. And I also get some problems of this problem section. When you finish the chapter, you have many, many problems. I solve almost all the pair problems. For example, chapter 5, and I solve number 2, number 4, maybe until 5.88. I have many, many problems. If you want to go there, please be sure to visit my webpage or to this course. Get into mass balance course and you will understand the structure, because many times YouTube limits me to linking webpage and that. But if you want to get a better understanding of the course, please go to this webpage. And if you really don't want that much theory, you want just problems, I have a lot of problems there you can practice, and I'm very sure you will get a lot better solving problems rather than just hear me talking about mass balances and stuff like that. There's also this book. I do recommend it. This is not that typical for mass balances, or at least I've heard that. This is more for energy balances, but they have a lot of chapters in mass balancing. It's the basic principles and calculations in chemical engineering. This is the guy, I think it's Himmelblau, and it's the 7th edition. I don't know if there's an 8th edition. I know there's my 7th edition, I have it here with me, but I also recommend to buy it. If you are like really, really, really need to find more problems, you can go here and you will have, I think, 3 or 4 chapters full of mass balances. Actually, it's in part 2 where it says material balance. And finally, but not least, you need to know the concepts. So let me tell you what I'm not going to explain you. I'm going to suppose you know it. It's arithmetics, how to add, subtract, multiplication, division, decimals, whatever. Now, also geometry, I'm not going to explain you how to get the area of a circle or the area of a rectangle, whatever. Perimeter, of course not. And volume, all that stuff. You need to know that. Conversion of units, this is, I think, easier for SI system. I think English system, changing from English to international system, is kind of scary, and many people don't like that, but that's real life. Sometimes you go to an oven, they operate that to in Fahrenheit, and you have no idea what's Fahrenheit. Or I think it's backwards always. Americans tell me what the hell is 1 Celsius degree. Yeah, I understand them. I don't get that much how much a Fahrenheit. So yeah. You will be doing a lot of conversions. Please be sure to know how to do that. Yeah, this is also what I was telling, how to understand the English system and international system. You need to know how to use decimals and scientific notation. So if I put 5.3 times 10 to the 3, I'm expecting you guys to know that this is 5,300. So, or also if I'm working with huge numbers like this, and I get, well, this is 1.7 times 10 to the 4th, be sure to know what I'm doing. Now, we're going to talk about also percentage and fractions. That's tricky if you don't know that much how to convert or fractions, but I'm expecting you to know that, guys. Now, that was mathematics. Let's talk about chemistry, physics, and all those sciences you saw in, I don't know, maybe mid school or high school. Please be sure to understand the difference between pressure and force. I think you've seen absolute temperatures and normal temperatures like Celsius and Rankine. Actually, Fahrenheit is the typical one in use in English units, and Rankine is the absolute in English system. Kelvin is the absolute temperature in international system. Also, this is very, very important. Maybe you're going to see this more in mass energy balance. Be sure to know that temperature is not the same as heat, which is just Q. So once you get that, cool. You don't need to understand this that much in this course, but be sure you just get the difference. And of course, mass is not weight. So if I tell you 300 Newton, that's force or weight. If I tell you 30 grams or 30 kilograms, that's mass. Okay? And the concept of mole, mass, weight, molar mass, mass fraction, mole fraction, all this stuff, please be sure to know them. I will refer to them maybe at the beginning. Like, I will remember you that mole fraction, it's a mole of I divided by mole, no, total mole, total. But I'm not going to explain you or be in every video explaining you, oh, remember, this is the definition, okay? You need to know basic chemistry, kinetics, and stoichiometry, so be sure how to balance an equation. And that, I'm going to review that, but please don't expect me to be that very worried about that. I'm just going to remind you how to do it, and hopefully you actually know it, because if you do not know it, you're going to have problems. Now, let's go to the actual content of the course. Maybe this is what you are interested in the most. Show you the slides. This is the introduction, single phase, multiple phase, and transient state. So this is, once again, chapter 4, chapter 5, chapter 6, and chapter 11. This is the content of our course. We're going to start after this video. We're going to start with the introduction. I broke it in two sections, which is section 1 and section 2. Section 1 is just theory, definitions, process, unit operations, streams, flow diagrams, block diagrams, variables, whatever. All that stuff that maybe it's new for you because it's the first engineering course you are in your bachelor. And finally, we go to understand some mass balance concepts. Now, section 2 is about mass balance basics. Once you understand the basics of engineering and diagram engineering, whatever, we're going to start doing mass balances in one unit, multiple units, with reaction and without reaction. We're going to do mass balancing combustions, and we're going to see what's a purge, what's a bypass, and a recycle. Then, of course, we're going to get along with theory, problems, and exercises. Once you master that, which I think that's the 50%, we're going to this 20%, which is single phase. It's this little section, which I would say is almost nothing. It's about theory, what's a phase. It's not the same as a state of matter, but anyways, I'm not going to explain that in here. We have liquids and solid in this part, and then section 2, I would say, is almost everything here. We're going to see the gases, which are pressure, temperature, and volume dependent. We start doing ideal gas, which is the best case scenario. Then we start doing real gas calculations. We use cubic equations, many other equations, and we start using the compressibility factor. And of course, it's not only about theory, it's application of that theory in mass balances. Now, this is chapter number 6. That's also 20% of the course, multiple phase. We've seen one phase mass balance, only one gas. Now we're going to see three sections. In these sections we have, I like to call these the vapor liquid, then we have K gas liquid system where only one condenses, and vapor gas where there condensate many. For example, you have water and air, only water condenses here. Where you have, I don't know, benzene and toluene, both condenses and both go in the vapor. And finally, we see solid liquid systems and liquid liquid systems. I don't know, maybe because I didn't have space, but we're going to see solid liquid systems and liquid liquid systems. This is just a small overview. The important thing here is section 1 and section 2. So section 1 is single phase theory. We're going to see phase theory, phase diagrams, whatever. We're going to see vapor pressure. We're going to see not only theory, but how to calculate the vapor pressure with Antoine equation, Clapeyron equation, all that. We're going to know when a system is set with the phase rule of Gibbs, or Gibbs phase rule. Now, once we know we can solve, we're going to start doing this type of problems, which is mass balances with gas liquid systems, evaporation, drying, humidity, humidifying, whatever. Then we start doing gas liquid systems with multi-condensable species. We need to start doing Raoult law, Henry law. We're going to see a small theory about that. This is typical for thermodynamics, but we're going to see a small review of this. We're going to understand what's dew point, bubble point, whatever. And also TXY diagrams. What's that? It's essentially, you have temperature and you have a composition. And not only that, we have PXY diagrams also. So something like this, pressure versus composition. And the final section of this block is solid liquid systems, which is solubility and saturation, and liquid liquid systems, which is extraction, essentially. So maybe you are saying, how come this can be only 20%? These are many, because you've seen 50% in the chapter 4, and you've seen 20% in the chapter 5. You have actually seen 70% of the content. So adding this 20% to this stuff you already know will make you actually this 90%. So yeah, maybe in content is a little bit, but in general, like the general idea of this is you are going to understand 90% of the mass balances. And finally, but not least, or actually yes, least, if you do not want to know this, which is not that common for courses, I did have some examples, but not that much. I would say it was only an overview of transient state. I'm not going to do that. I'm going to show you a little bit more. This is chapter 11. This is only 10% of the course, and we will talk about section 1, which is theory, the accumulation concept, when to apply transient states in mass balance, some cases and examples and applications. Now, once you know what we're talking about, let's go to section 2, which is just exercises, integral balances, mass balances, differential balances, all this stuff apply, and we will see that many times, because the equation has a derivative of mass with respect with time, we will need to solve this with computer, because we will have many terms here, x, time, and mass, and whatever. You cannot solve it, or at least you cannot solve it that easily. So we see a little bit of how to solve that. And thank God we're done, guys. This was the end of the introduction. You should be now getting an idea of mass balance. Hopefully you are good at math and analytical skills, because you are going to use them. Actually, the best students or the guys that get the most are the guys that are very good in math or guys that are very analytical. They know there was a stream here and then they have this and they tell you, hey, why not this? Or why this is a percentage here? Why this fraction goes only here, or they are thinking about everything. If you like chemical processes, how to build up, I don't know, ammonia or benzene, naphtha, amines, many, many processes, you will like this, because we're going to see a lot of chemical processes. Maybe you don't need to know the chemistry behind that, but you do need to know the mass balance around that. And yeah, essentially, you need to have a lot of patience. Be patient, guys. Patience, because you are going to have sometimes where you have no idea what you're doing and you think you're not getting the idea or you're just lost. Just be patient and remember that study, 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 and do a lot of problems. If you practice, you will always get to that. You will always get it, but you need to practice a lot of problems. Do a lot, many, many problems. The more you make, the best. Theory alone will not help. Like, I can tell you, okay, let's get this in and let's get this out. But if you've never done a mass balance, you will not understand the idea. As an introductory course to chemical engineering, it's super important to learn it 100%. Actually, if I had to choose what course should someone learn the most in all chemical engineering, I would say mass balancing. Mass balancing will open you doors everywhere. To all the courses I showed you before, to chemical, plant processes, whatever. And yeah, essentially I think we're done. You need more information, you can get it here. My Facebook page. This is not that technical or study stuff. I just upload whatever chemical engineering stuff I got or I saw in the internet. You need help, you can send me an email. Gladly, I will answer you. Or go directly to the webpage. This is a good idea. I have many problems here. Problems of the course, not on the webpage. Go to the courses and you will find mass balance course there. Click on it, find the theory. I have more content here than in YouTube, so I think it's a good idea to go here. And yeah, essentially, we're done. That's the bibliography. And yeah, see you in the next video. Thank you guys for choosing this course. I think you will not regret it. And if that's the point, just send me messages on what should I do for making you happy. So see you in the next video. What's up guys, it's me, Chemical Engineering Guy. So if you like the video, why not push the like button? It really helps me to know if you're liking the videos or if I should be changing something or I should be adding something, taking out content, whatever. Also, sharing is caring. So if you got any kind of friends, teachers, colleagues, or whatever kind of person that might be interested in this type of content, why not share it? Sharing helps our community to grow faster in members and in content. If you want to keep track of my activity, videos, uploads, experiments, playlists, whatever content I'm getting on YouTube, be sure to click the subscribe button. Subscribing to the channel is totally free, guys. My dream is to create an online academy of chemical engineering, where everyone can access it in the world. Imagine a place in which the student, the teacher, and the engineer get the best of each other. Thank you guys for the support and the love.